Lord, you're with you, and also with all of you. Good afternoon. It's great to see all of you here. I'm Eric Hennekamp. I'm the Transformational General Presbyter and Stated Clerk of Black Hawk Presbytery. That's quite a mouthful. We generally abbreviate it to TGPSC. I bring you greetings from the other 70 congregations and nearly 9,000 members of Black Hawk Presbytery. As you know, this is a worship service, but it is a worship service and installation that is done by the presbytery. So this is officially a presbytery meeting and worship service. I'm a lifelong friend of Reverend Jenny Hubbard and her family, probably longer than either one of us would like to admit. We have served together in a number of places at Knox Presbyterian Church, the Indian Prairie Great Banquet, youth events. We're both fellow McCormick Seminary alum. And it is such a joy to take place in this special worship service to finally and officially install Jenny as pastor of your congregation. So thank you all for coming this day. Let's hear these words of Scripture. Clap your hands, all you people. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. For the Most High is awesome, a great sovereign over all the earth. It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praises to your name, O Most High. Friends, let's pray together. Almighty and eternal God, by your grace you have called us in this time and place to be your servant people as we follow our servant Lord. Make your Holy Spirit move within us and among us that together we may live a new life in the crucified and risen Christ. Bind us together in faith so that as we receive all spiritual gifts needed to fulfill our calling, we may support one another in common ministry through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
When we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In humility and faith, let us confess our sin to God. Almighty God, by water and your Holy Spirit, you baptize us to be your own and call the church into being. We confess that we hold back the love of your Spirit among us. We do not listen to your word of grace, speak the good news of your love, or live as people made us one in Christ. Have mercy on us, O God. Transform our lives by the power of your Holy Spirit, and make strong our common witness to the one Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ. God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which God loved us, even when we were dead through our sin, make us alive together with Christ, and raise us up with him. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Amen.
Good afternoon. Prayer of illumination. Let us pray. Overwhelm us with your Spirit, O God, that the words we hear will speak to our hearts as your word, made known to us in Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. Our first scripture reading is Isaiah 43, verses 1 through 3, and 54, verse 10. But now, this is what the Lord says. He who has created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned, The flames will not set you ablaze, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One, O Israel, your Savior. I have given Egypt as a ransom for you, Cush and Seba in your place. Though the mountains move and the hills shake, my love will not be removed from you, and my covenant of peace will not be shaken, says your compassionate Lord. Our second reading is Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, in any comfort from his love, in any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit, and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interest, but to each of you, to the interests of the others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
An installation service is a wonderful time to celebrate the unique relationship between pastor and congregation. Called together through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, this is a bond of care and trust, of hope and deep relationships, to be encouraged from being united with Christ. I want to share just a short message this afternoon about one way, one unique way to look at this relationship between Jenny and this congregation. Many years ago, my wife Patty and I lived in a charming little house in San Fernando Valley, just north of Los Angeles. There wasn't anything unique about our quiet neighborhood at all, but there was something extraordinary about a house that was just two blocks away from where we lived. It was a pink stucco home with an enormous trapeze set up in the backyard that you couldn't miss when you walked by. The house was owned by a TV and movie stuntman named Bob Yerkes. He used his home to practice stunts and to teach others about his craft. He was also famous for teaching celebrities on the old TV show you may remember, Circus of the Stars. How many of you have seen Circus of the Stars? You know, today we have Dancing with the Stars, and often we say stars. They're not the best stars out there. Back then, we had Circus of the Stars. So as we walked by Bob's backyard, you never knew who you'd see. But there was always some activity as people flew through the air and Bob yelling instructions and encouragement to them. Maybe it was Brooke Shields and Scott Baio jumping from trapeze to trapeze. I was walking our dog one time and saw Debbie Reynolds and Bob Newhart walking into the house front door together. I'm assuming many of you have been to the circus. Is there anyone here who has not been to a circus? It's quite an experience. There's clowns and jugglers. There used to be a lot of animals, not so much anymore. It's the sounds and smell that you only get under the big top. What many people find most entertaining at the circus is just like at our neighbor's house, the trapeze acts. We're dazzled as acrobats swing effortlessly through the air, leaping and twisting, doing somersaults, defying gravity and defying fate. The flyer uses his body to gain momentum as they leap off, picking up speed, going higher and higher by pumping their legs. At the same time, the catcher begins swinging in a slower pattern, hanging on by his knees, hands out, waiting for the flyer. Then, at just the right moment, the flyer lets go and sails through the air, and the catcher reaches out and they lock hands. As we watch, we cheer and gasp and clap, and it's an exhilarating spectacle. One of my favorite Christian authors is the late Henry Nouwen. Some of you may know his writings. Nouwen was a Catholic priest, a Harvard professor, and a very prolific writer. Nouwen suggested there's a great deal that we can learn about our Christian faith by studying trapeze acts, about hope and about trust. Nouwen came to this conclusion after seeing a performance by a trapeze group from South Africa. He was so fascinated by what they did, he became close friends with them and kept in touch with this circus troupe. He'd send letters, he would visit them, and he would even try out the trapeze up until the time when he was in his 60s. In discussions with his circus friends, Nouwen learned the secret of the trapeze act. He says, when we watch the trapeze show, we're transfixed by the flyers. They wear fancy costumes, dancing in the air. So our focus is on the stars soaring above us. But if we spotlight the flyer, we miss the maneuvers are only possible because of the catcher. Everything depends on the catcher. Here's a short quote from one of Nouwen's books. If we're to take risks, to be free in the air in life, we have to know there's a catcher. We have to know that when we come down from it all, we're going to be caught, we're going to be safe. We must trust the catcher. The flyer's job is to jump in faith and hope for the catcher to bring him in safely. I believe this imagery speaks to us all today, having a relationship with Jesus, who is the ultimate catcher, means that at times we all need to take risks, to let go of what we know, to trust one another with our lives. True religion includes leaps of faith over and over again. So you may be wondering, what does this image of trapeze acts have to do with installing a pastor? Anybody wondering about that? Well, I want to suggest that in many ways, the work of a pastor is sometimes like that of a high-flying trapeze artist. We're the one at center stage on Sunday morning, at weddings, at funerals and baptisms, dressed in robes and fancy souls, we stand out among the crowds who watch us, listen to us. Our message is always about Jesus, but we're the ones visible up front, elevated, so everyone can see us. Friends, it's a risk to be a pastor. We don't work for glory, and we don't work for spectacle. And we often work without a net in case we fall. But like the acrobat, the leap of the pastor, the message of the preacher, the care of the minister is nothing without those who receive it. The congregation can be our catcher. It's a beautiful, powerful, intimate relationship between pastor and congregation. We share personal stories, we pray for one another. And there are also times when those roles are reversed, when the members are the flyers and the pastor is the catcher. Children and visitors come to us with fresh, new faith. People visit our offices to speak of heavy hearts, broken dreams, and doubts. They too are jumping, letting go of the shifting life that they grasp, that bar they grasp onto so firmly, hoping that there's someone there to catch them. And we do. As pastors, we do. In many ways, all of our relationships of faith are like those acrobats in the air. Our message from the prophet Isaiah this afternoon has something to say about that leap of faith that we take. The voice of God comes through the prophet, "Fear not, I have redeemed you. When you pass through the waters, I'll be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through fire, you will not be burned." And maybe we could add, "When you let go of your trapeze, I will catch you and not let you fall." A key role of the pastor is to help people learn how to let go of what they have in their lives and to soar free. Letting go is at the heart of our religious work. One of the most basic things we learn in Scripture and throughout worship is that we have to let go of one thing, and that is that we are in charge, because we're not. Guys, faith is the opposite of control. It's surrendering. We open our arms, our hearts to you all, the fellow acrobats here in church and in our world. As a pastor, we're witnesses who show it's safe to let go. Let go of hate, let go of bias, of anger, and of fear. And ultimately, what we learn from this metaphor is that the pastor and the congregation take turns being the catcher for one another. We are there as we twist and turn and somersault our way through life, sometimes in big ways, in life's most jarring transitions. But most often, we're just there in the little ways. We catch each other by praying for one another, writing a card or dropping off a meal, recognizing each other for the child of God that we are, and knowing that we can't do any of this alone. So for Jenny and all of you, let us soar when we pray together. Serve together, sing together, laugh together, cry together. By doing that, we can help one another soar to new heights. but always remember, the secret of that trapeze of life is that we have to trust the catcher. Amen. Imagination.
Will you be a faithful elder in our team? I'm here at the 1.3. Will you be a faithful pastor, proclaiming the good news in word and sacrament, teaching faith and caring for people? Will you actively serve in government and discipline, serving the councils of the church and in your ministry? Will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you? To you, the congregation, do this and you can say, right, good mother. Do you, the members of this church, accept Jenny as your pastor, chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to guide you in the way of Jesus Christ? Do you? Do you agree to pray for her, to encourage her, to respect her decisions, and to follow as she guides you, serving Jesus Christ who alone is the head of the church? Do you? Do you promise to pay her fairly and provide for her welfare as she works among you, to stand by her in trouble and share her joys? Will you listen to the words she preaches, welcome her pastoral care, and honor her authority as she seeks to honor and obey Jesus Christ your Lord? Do you? It's time for ordination prayer, or the installation prayer. Yes, Lord. That you too. All right, let's pray. God, we thank you so much for Jenny. We thank you for her love for you. I thank you for this church and for your Holy Spirit working in this church and through her life and bringing them together. We ask you, Lord, to fill Jenny with your spirit, with your presence, with your direction. Affirm your love and presence with her today. Lord, continue to soften the heart of this church as she preaches and cares and loves on them. And may you do your great ministry through the heart of this church, that people may come to know you, to live for you, and that justice and reconciliation might be seen. In Jesus' name, amen. First Samuel 1, 27 and 28, hear the word of the Lord. For this child I prayed, and the Lord answered the request that I prayed to the Lord. Therefore I've loaned this child to the Lord. As long as this child lives, this child is given to the Lord. And Hannah left the child there for the Lord. The word of the Lord. Grace and peace be with you. Grace and peace. It is with total joy that I am with you today on this occasion. I want to say that again. It's with total joy that I am with you today on this occasion. Jenny, I'm sure you've heard some stories, and some of them are true. Okay. These last 6 years have been very creative around here. There's been lots of surprising times, lots of confusing times, lots of taking account times, lots of growing and knowing pain times, and simply lots of times. The twists and turns of the years have pushed and pulled on the minds, hearts, and emotions of this congregation. And now, as a congregation, as a family of God, as a people called by the name of the Lord Jesus, you are here with you. And I truly believe in answering prayers. Jenny, you preached your candidate sermon at First Presbyterian Lawrence. And even before we heard you, I was thankful for the possibility of the Lord calling you to this place. Yes. Your entire life has been one of being in the presence of God. Sometimes whether you liked it or not, but you were there. Your mother's participation in your home church meant that you grew up within the walls of the church, much like the same. whether she ever stated in prayer to you, you were a gift within gifting walls of a loving community of faith. This meant that your entire life is immersed in spirit life and breath of the community of faith. For you truly are a growing child of God. You've observed how people of faith share the love of God and how they struggle through difficult decisions and transitions in life. You've watched firsthand baptisms and confirmations, marriages and deaths. You've witnessed the celebrating new members to the family of God. And you've also used those who depart in anger or bitterness towards a family of faith that they once loved, felt, embraced. You are gifted by your family, place, and experience with an interwoven fabric of identity and second nature intuition of what's going on. And that can only come from experience and repetition of being there. You know the church. You know the relational dynamics. And you know how essential it is to have servant leaders who only live honest, even struggling examples of Christ-centeredness for the family of God. And in spite of all that, you've seen in and you've witnessed in the church, you still responded to the call of God as a minister and sacrament. You served your home church family faithfully even before you acknowledged your call, but you still said yes to the Lord. And not half-heartedly, but with a dogged determination through thick and thin times to do the necessary preparation to be faithful to the call of the Lord. No shortcuts. No special dispensations. Your shaped and committed spirit over the years propelled you, sometimes rapidly, but more often through seemingly imperceptibly snail speed, slowness, towards your goal of acquiring useful tools for ministry, which can be surprisingly helpful in serving God. Now you are here with your flock, with your call, with your opportunity to lead and help shape the minds and hearts of the dear family of God. I encourage you to remember those who shaped your environment of love, for that gift can sustain your mind and heart and extend that faithful environment here at Hillside. I challenge you to continue to deploy the tools you've honed and used. For here is your new family, your new place, where you can freely and creatively use them. And lastly, I offer you a gift from the life of Dr. Byron McCain, another child of the church, as I am. He was my seminary roommate. Byron did his parish field ed at a rural Southern Baptist church in Wauconda, Illinois, with my then-aged, retired Southern Baptist father with Parkinson's disease at the time. Byron would spend the weekends with my mom and dad, and so he'd eat breakfast with my father. And my father made terrible oatmeal, tried to act like he liked it. You know? And so across that little bitty table, Byron asked my dad, "Brother Backus, what's the most important thing in ministry?" And Dad replied, "Oh, that terrible oatmeal. Love the Lord. Love your people." Lord bless you.
A single girl family. Do you remember how much we prayed when we didn't have a pastor? We prayed, and we prayed Sunday after Sunday. We prayed as we wondered about our past, we worried about our future, and we had to dig down to find that faith that God had a plan for us. God is good. He is faithful. He has blessed us with Pastor Jenny. And we are so indeed thankful. Because she has given us hope. Hope that indeed, yes, there's a plan. We have a future. We have a purpose. Now, we called her here, reminding us all not to do all the work. You see, what I know of this family is we've always had a lot of worker bees. We were raised to know the value of work. We're not afraid of work. We have gifts and talents in this church, but what we didn't have was a queen bee. We had the worker bees, but we needed a feminine example. Queen bee, right? Someone who has the gift of leadership, the gift of ministry, the gift of teaching, the gift of building relationships. That's what we needed. And we need Reverend Jenny to remind us that with all of our gifts and differences and talents, we are all part of one body, the body of Christ. And all this work we do, we should do in the unity of the body, Jesus Christ. And the work we do, it's not for our own glory. It's not for the glory of this church, although there's a lot of pride in this church. It is work to the glory of God. And now we look to Pastor Jenny to lead us into that future, into that calling that we can live out God's plan for us. So let us leave here remembering, really important, that we're catchers and that she'll catch us, yes. And to remember the promises that we have made. The promise that we will encourage Pastor Jenny. That we will respect her. And that we will follow her as she leads us in serving our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And we invite you to offer your gifts in the offering plate as you leave here today. Just give them out of gratitude, right? Out of thanksgiving that God has answered our prayers. Out of gratitude for God's providence, for His faithfulness. And the offerings today will be given to the Black Hawk Emergency Fund for pastors. So, a good cause.
Thank you. Thank you, Roy, Eric, and Lori, Jessica, and Jerry for participating. And thank you for calling me here. For calling me to be your pastor, your catcher. And I am filled with gratitude knowing that you will catch me also. And that this is a true partnership. So let us pray. Dear Lord, I am filled with gratitude to this congregation, to these people here today, to all the beautiful words said, the heartfelt words that show us that you are here, your Holy Spirit is guiding us and leading us, carrying us forward to follow your word and to be present for one another. We know that this time is not what we expected with this virus. But yet we look to you with thanksgiving in our hearts at the many ways that we are finding to connect with one another, to be with one another, to lift each other up in prayer, and though we may not all be physically together at all times, may it be so that we are spiritually together at all times, that we move forward in unity in you. And in that unity, we all pray the prayer that your Lord, Son, Jesus Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Brought a benediction today that a pastor that I worked with for a short time, he was an interim for only a few months, but he would say the same thing at the end of every service. And I just thought it was appropriate for today. We go nowhere by accident. Wherever we go, God has sent us. Wherever we are, God has placed us there. Christ, who lives within us, has something to accomplish through us. So let us believe this and go in God's grace, go in God's love, and go in God's power.